would you consider to be natural? Take a look at this environment. There's been a lot of landscaping by local residents, by Castor canadensis, the North American beaver. Their landscaping tool of choice? Their teeth. They gnaw branches and trees, they create dams.
And in doing so, they create new habitat for amphibians and fish, and they also displace residents that used to live there. Insects, mammals, few organisms on this planet can change the landscape the way that beavers can. Humans, of course, are another notable example. And there's a course of study devoted to understanding this interaction between the human-made built environment of the city and the non-human residents. It's called urban ecology.
The definition of ecology is how organisms interact with each other and with the environment in which they live. So urban ecology is how organisms interact with their environment in an urban setting. If you had learned about ecology several decades ago, you'd be going to, you know, the rainforest in South America or some natural environment somewhere. No ecologist would have even dreamed of doing anything in the city. That's not where ecology happened, apparently. Ecology happens everywhere. People were always separated from nature, and that's part of what's gotten us into some of the trouble we're in right now. Ecology was seen as being done somewhere remote, pristine, natural. People were not part of the ecology, and we've learned in the last bunch of decades that that's just not right. That's not how it works. People are part of the environment. We are part of the ecosystem. Ecology does happen in urban areas. It's very important for the landscape, for us, for everyone involved.
Ecosystem services refer to all the benefits a healthy functioning ecosystem brings to us. We drink fresh water in New York City that really is basically unfiltered in many cases because the water has been cleaned by going through the ecosystems north of the city. Pollination is another ecosystem service. One-third of the crops we eat are pollinated by insects and birds. The other is by wind, which is another ecosystem service.
In ecology, we're learning the urban environment is just as important as any other environment. A scientist is someone who goes out, learns things, is curious about things, and then comes up with questions based on observations that they've made. In the case of an urban ecologist, you know, me for instance, I go out to parks here in the city, I go to natural areas in the city, just walking around the city, there's ecology everywhere. We have major influences on the urban ecosystem. We change the environment around us. A lot of the natural processes that happen get altered.
One of the subjects urban ecologists study is species composition. In other words, which species live where, and what factors influence those populations. American Museum of Natural History postdoc Mark Weckel studies that question here in Van Cortlandt Park in the Bronx. He's specifically interested in coyotes and what role humans have played in their recent immigration to NYC.
Van Cortlandt is one of several parks that my colleagues and I have been monitoring for several years. We use camera traps as our main tool, which is basically a camera that's triggered by the movement of a warm-bodied animal. And so it basically takes pictures of whatever walks by. In this case, it runs all night, all day, and there's no delay. So it takes a picture anytime an animal's triggering it. And it also takes 5 photographs in a row. So what the beautiful thing is we've gotten almost what you call near video photography of images of coyote moms with their pups. And I have pictures from the Bronx of deer sparring, which I think is pretty cool. So where we're staying right now in the Bronx, back in 1609, when Henry Hudson was sailing up the Hudson River, there would have been an eastern wolf here. Over time, as colonists, followed by early Americans, cleared the forest, they also eliminated most of the large predators, including the eastern wolf.
There's even a specific term for this.
Humans defaunated the landscape, is a nice way of saying it. Got rid of the fauna, especially these large predators that were seen as competitors and vilified, to be honest with you. Earlier in our history, they were seen as evil.
By the 1960s, in the northeast of the United States, there were no wolves left. Meanwhile, the western coyote was having almost the reverse experience.
What happened since that time is that the western coyote has actually done quite well for itself and expanded its range.
Over the past 150 years, western coyotes moved east and north from their original home range. Weckl says one of their expansion routes was through Ontario in Canada.
He says this is where western coyotes began to breed with eastern wolves and possibly other canid species.
Their offspring are what we now call the eastern coyote. These eastern coyotes have also expanded in range, moving east and south into the northeastern United States.
When the eastern coyote showed up via Ontario, they found a landscape right for the taking.
There were no competitor wolves, and instead of farmland, the eastern coyote found suburbia.
And the eastern coyote that we have is quite adaptable to that landscape.
In the last few years, coyotes have been spotted in Manhattan, Queens, and right here in Van Cortlandt Park in the Bronx, not far from where this story began. From the camera traps, Weckl gets insight into what species live where and how animals interact with this urban environment. Tammy Lewis, an environmental sociologist, is interested in how people interact with their environment.
We are at Brooklyn Bridge Park, which is built on the old industrial piers that are here along the waterfront on the East River. One of the reasons I'm interested in this park has to do with urban sustainability and has to do with amenities that are created in cities that can be good for both nature, but also humans. So as an environmental sociologist, I'm interested in how we create urban spaces that improve quality of life for human beings that are part of the ecosystem.
So one of the things that I was thinking as you were talking about trying to figure out whether this park is sustainable is how you turn that story of this park into something you can study or quantify or compare with other stories. How do you approach that in a scientific way?
That's a really interesting question. And I mean, social scientists use data just like natural scientists do. And so, you know, one of the things I'm interested in looking at is what happens when you have a place like this that used to be, you know, kind of a wasteland. So after the industrial use was over, it laid fallow for many, many years. And so how do you look at, you know, kind of before the park came and after the park came? And one of the things that social scientists often use is census data.
How do you pick which parks to study?
It's a really important question because that's an issue of sampling, and you want to be able to pick, first of all, a park that's representative in some way. But I don't just study Brooklyn Bridge Park because that's special in a lot of ways. And so I need to look at the population that I'm interested in. So for example, if I'm interested in understanding New York City's parks, all of the parks in New York City are my population. Now, one person alone can't study all those parks in depth, so I have to figure out how to generate a sample of parks. If I just look at Brooklyn Bridge Park in depth, then I can provide a nice history of the development of a single park, but I won't be able to generalize in any way because it's just a case of one.
Data from parks and other parts of the urban environment can be used to guide conservation efforts.
We can't conserve anything unless we can include people. People have a very tied connection to the environment, and so we need to make sure that we're not just working on the ecosystem, but we're also working with people. New York is traditionally categorized as a hard concrete environment. The fact remains that it is also very biologically diverse in terms of the different types of habitats and ecosystems that are represented in New York City as an urban environment and the biodiversity that exists here. So I think it's time for us to really start thinking about and revisiting what it means to live in an urban environment such as New York City and start integrating our natural landscape, our natural wildlife, with our average city life. It's not separate, they're really very much integrated. And the more that people can start to think about their relationship with nature in New York City, the better we can be as a community in the conservation efforts.